A Portrait of a Pioneer, Elmo Pickerill. Pioneers. Great names such as Armstrong, DeForest, Marconi, and others are becoming memories. Let me tell you the story of a pioneer that I knew. His name will not be written in history, for he was just an ordinary man. The scene is the barren waiting room of the Mineola Long Island Railroad Station. A lonely figure slumps forward. The end. He leaves no close relatives to mourn him or a worldly estate. But had he been lonely? For he had friends that money could not buy and memories that only the great could cherish. See if you don't agree. Elmo Pickerill was born in 1885. When a young man, he became a railroad telegrapher. Like many others, he journeyed to the St. Louis World's Fair in the year 1904. And who is most qualified to tell what he saw? Why, none other than the young man himself. Tell us about it, Pick.
In the early part of 1904, I was working for the Terminal Railroad Association of St. Louis in the Union Railroad Station at St. Louis, and saw articles in the newspapers about wireless telegraphy that was to be exhibited at the World's Fair. And being a telegrapher, I was skeptical, and I was also interested. Nobody at that time thought that it was possible to send messages from here to there without the aid of wires, and I wanted to see what it was all about. So one day I went out to the World's Fair, and while there I met Dr. Lee DeForest.
And here are the two people he met. Dr. Lee DeForest and his erstwhile associate, Abraham White, at their 1904 World's Fair exhibit. Lee DeForest took an immediate liking to the young man and hired him to operate his Colorado station. This may be our first mobile installation. What happened, Pick, after he hired you?
When the St. Louis World's Fair closed late in 1904, the wireless apparatus used there for demonstration purposes was boxed and shipped to Japan, accompanied by an American radio operator named Harry E. Athern, for service in the Russo-Japanese War. Athern installed a station on a point of land in Japan where the Russian naval fleet would have to pass on its way to Vladivostok. Having left Russia 3 months previously via the Baltic, Mediterranean, and Indian Ocean, another installation was made on Admiral Togo's flagship, secreted in a bay with the Japanese naval fleet, 90 miles north of the coastal station. Observers at the coastal station flashed information to Admiral Togo of the line formation of the important Russian battleships of the badly disorganized Russian fleet, which had left Russia 3 months previously for Vladivostok. When the Russian fleet reached the bay where the Japanese Navy was concealed, Admiral Togo rushed out with his fleet and sank the entire Russian fleet, consisting of more than 160 warships, thus ending the Russo-Japanese War. This was the first time that wireless was used in warfare.
At the closing of the fair, Pickerill went to Colorado, where he helped build a wireless station, which was used primarily for stock promotion. Here's the young man at the station. Tell us about the equipment you used.
First, the apparatus consisted of a 2-kilowatt open-core transformer, an 18 Leyden jar condenser, a spark gap, helix type aerial tuning inductance, a hand key, and a changeover switch for switching from transmitting to receiving. The receiver consisted of an electrolytic detector, a 3-coil tuning inductance with 5 slides and a pair of head telephones. The exterior of the station, the mast was 160 feet high, and we had a 6-wire antenna going to the top of this antenna.
Doc DeForest and his young friend Pickerill. As radio historians know, DeForest was a victim of Abraham White's stock promotional deals. Here is a rare telegram that I have. It was written by DeForest to White. What happened, Pick, after your early radio adventures out there in the West?
In 1908, I erected a wireless telegraph station for the United Wireless Telegraph Company on the roof garden of the original Waldorf Astoria Hotel at 34th Street and 5th Avenue, New York City, now the site of the Empire State Building, which I operated for the next 3 years. This station was used for both marine and intercity communication with the Bellevue Stratford Hotel station in Philadelphia, the DuPont station in Wilmington, Delaware, and the Willard Hotel in Washington, D.C. also with steamships entering and departing from the port of New York.
This newspaper clipping tells me you were also doing something other than radio work in 1910. Pick, how in the world did you ever get mixed up in aviation?
Well, having gone to sea as a radio operator, I realized the value of communication with any kind of transportation. And I became curious, wondering whether it would ever be possible to operate radio from an airplane in flight with the ground. And having met the Wright brothers a few times on their frequent trips to New York at the Waldorf Astoria, one day I asked Orville Wright if he thought it would be possible, and he said it was very doubtful whether it would be possible to fly the airplane and operate radio. So I asked him if he would rent me an airplane with the services of a pilot. And he said the airplane being built of wood or bamboo and fabric and very little metal, he doubted if it could be done. And he doubted if one man could handle it, that there was no airplane with sufficient power at that time to fly with two men and a lot of radio junk. So I asked him if it wouldn't be possible to teach me how to fly so I could fly my own airplane and in that way do away with the weight of a second man. And he pointed out that there were two levers on the Wright machine, and I would have to hold on to both those levers at all times. So I conceived the idea of placing a push-button type telegraph key on the top of the right lever so I could hold on to the lever and operate this key with my thumb. And he told me that the only way he could give me instruction would be on a catch-as-catch-can basis because they had no regularly established flying school at that time. After qualifying as a pilot, I built a radio transmitter and receiver and installed it on a Wright airplane. And on August 4th, took off on a flight for Manhattan Beach here on Long Island. I was in the air only a few seconds when I heard the portable station that I had set up on the beach at Manhattan Beach calling me. And after I got clear of the trees, I answered him, and then he wanted to know how I heard his signals. I told him that I could hear him okay and carried on a two-way conversation with him, after which I worked with three other steamships in the harbor in New York and with two other steamships that were steaming along the south shore of Long Island. I also operated with the Marconi Coastal Station at Seagate, Long Island, and another coastal station at Sagaponack, near Babylon, Long Island, and a station at number 42 Broadway. When I reached Manhattan Beach, the engine was operating so well that I decided to turn around and land back in Mineola. And after 1 hour and 3 minutes, I made this round trip of approximately 40 miles, requiring just 1 hour and 3 minutes. When I arrived back in Mineola, I was told that I had broken the long distance round trip record for an airplane flight.
Well, as a wireless operator, Pick, you certainly have had numerous experiences. I noticed over here another write-up where you were the shore operator at the time of Walter Wellman's historic balloon flight across the Atlantic, which met disaster. And here's a picture of Jack Irwin, another famous pioneer wireless operator such as yourself, who was aboard the ill-fated balloon which dropped in the North Atlantic. And, well, here are the three of you. Left to right, we have Ginsburg, the operator on the SS Trent, which was the rescue ship. Then Irwin, the balloon operator, who of course sent the distress call. And over there at the far right, of course, is you, Pick. You were manager of the Waldorf Astoria station, I believe, and you were the one who brought the news to the world. What happened? Now, the Waldorf Astoria station, what happened, Pick, after the station closed down?
The Waldorf Astoria station was closed and dismantled on December 31st, 1910, whereupon I resumed going to sea as radio operator on steamships of various steamship lines sailing out of New York, mostly to Panama during construction of the canal and to Central and South American ports. By coincidence, I happened to be the operator on the steamship Kroonland, making an 83-day cruise with 450 passengers from New York via the Panama Canal down the west coast of South America through the Straits of Magellan and stopping at the principal cities on the east coast of South America on the way back to New York. On February 2nd, 1915, the Kroonland was the first steamship to pay a toll for passage through the Panama Canal on that cruise. Later in 1915, I was sent to Honolulu to operate the 200 kilowatt Marconi Trans-Pacific Station, which was used to relay traffic between San Francisco and Japan. When the First World War started getting hot in Europe, I left Hawaii and sailed from San Francisco for New York on the steamship Manchuria sailing around Cape Horn. On account of a big landslide taking place in the Calibra Cut at Panama Canal, the day before the ship reached Panama, causing the canal to be closed for several months, the ship proceeded on to Coronel, Chile, for coal that had not yet been mined, causing more than another month's delay, after which the Manchuria resumed on its way to New York via Cape Horn. After arriving in New York, the Manchuria sailed between New York and the Tilbury docks in London, carrying TNT for the Allies. German submarines were chasing us most of the time, causing the crew to wear life preservers at all times, even when sleeping.
Well, even though Pick was spending much of his time now at sea, he had not lost his interest in aviation. This was the golden age of flying. All kinds of new machines were being tried and tested. Where were you, Pick, about the time we entered the war?
When the USA became involved in the First World War, I was commissioned a first lieutenant in the U.S. Army Air Service and served as officer in charge of a radio school at Ellington Field, Houston, Texas, in addition to my other duties as airplane pilot. 2 years after the armistice, I resigned my commission in the U.S. Army Air Service and returned to New York and was appointed Assistant Superintendent of the RCA, Radio Corporation of America.
Pickerill is an amazing man. Everyone seemed to have either known or worked with him. Quite to my surprise, I found that our friend and pioneer Clarence Tuska, co-founder of the ARRL, was a roommate of Pick's during the service. You can see Clarence there at the left. Pick continued his interest in radio as well as aviation after the war. He first joined the newly formed Radio Corporation of America and then was selected to be the chief radio officer of the great steamship Leviathan. In this capacity, he met and worked with many well-known commercial operators and present-day amateurs, including Charlie Mass, W2RTV, and Tony Tamarino, K4BX. Included in this group was pioneer engineer Louis Clement, who worked with Pick at the Marconi station in Hawaii and later helped outfit the Leviathan. Lou is seen at center right with glasses. Suppose we continue and have Pick tell us the story.
When the U.S. Shipping Board decided to recondition and put into service in 1923, the steamship Leviathan, the largest ship in the world at that time, I was selected to be chief radio officer. I joined the ship at Newport News, Virginia, where the ship was being reconditioned after its service as a transport during the First World War. All of the wartime radio apparatus was dismantled and replaced by more modern RCA radio apparatus. After making the first trip speed tests up and down the U.S. coast, the Leviathan entered the transatlantic passenger service, leaving New York on July 4th, 1923 on her maiden trip. The ship sailed to Cherbourg, France, Southampton, England, and later it also made trips to Bremerhaven, Germany, where it remained in service for several years. It had a capacity of 3,750 passengers and carried one of the first CW tube transmitters, a 10-kilowatt water-cooled transmitter. Experiments with radio telephone were conducted for 2 years on the Leviathan before it was put into universal service on other ships. The Leviathan also was the first ship to carry a radio direction finder. After serving for 5 years as chief radio officer on the Leviathan, my services there were interrupted by being appointed in charge of the aeronautical division of RCA for aeronautical radio research, which required my services sitting in the pilot seat of an 8-passenger airplane while making numerous radio tests with direction finders, transmitters, receivers, and conducting many experiments in the development of radio apparatus used on the airlines today.
Pick served as official RCA pilot for several years, and then back to his old love, the Leviathan again. Now, what happened after your last sea duty, Pick?
On June 1st, 1933, I transferred to shore duty again as operating technician at the central control console in the New York main office, where radio circuits from 86 different countries terminated and were distributed from the console to operating positions at many different points throughout the RCA building. These circuits handled just about everything known in the radio art, including tape recorders, printers, pictures, commercial traffic, broadcasts from all over the world for rebroadcasting, etc. On June 1st, 1950, I was retired by RCA, having reached my 65th birthday on May 24th.
By now, most of you must be wondering how Pick and I got together to reminisce about the old days. On one occasion, I was the guest speaker at the annual banquet of the Radio Club of America. My dinner partner, as you see, was my old friend Pick, along with Lloyd Espenscheid and Harry Houck. He invited me to return that evening to his home in Mineola. I had to refuse, but promised I would the next time I was in New York. This occurred later when I was guest speaker at the Veteran Wireless Operators Association's dinner. He welcomed both Link and I to his home. We took pictures of his favorite subjects, one of which, of course, was the Leviathan. His den was an unforgettable scene. Hundreds of photographs, citations, and mementos. It was an occasion to remember as he sat there tape recording for me over 60 years of adventure. Pick, isn't that a replica of a bust of Lee DeForest over there?
Yes, that bust was made by an artist friend of mine named Frederick Allen Williams on 57th Street in New York City. And at that time, I was president of the DeForest Pioneers, and that organization had this bust made, and a dinner was given to Dr. DeForest on the roof garden of the Waldorf Astoria Hotel on Park Avenue in New York, at which time this bust was presented to him. Rather, it was presented to the Yale University's alma mater, and the next day I drove up to Yale University in New Haven and gave it to the president of the university.
What are those funny-looking boxes over there on the table? They look like plaster of Paris imprints.
About 2 years ago, the 20th Century Fox called me on the telephone, told me they had a new picture, most of which had been photographed during the First World War, called The Magnificent Men in Their Flying Machines, and that they were not quite sure that all of the machines were what they were captioned to be, as French Spads, Newports, the English Sopwith Camel, and some of the American machines, and asked me if I would go and see a preview of the film before they presented it to the public. I went up there and did this job for them. Then About a year later, they called me up and told me they had another picture called the Blue Max, and asked me if I would come and view that picture for the same reason, which I did. And instead of making footprints in the concrete out on the sidewalk, as they often do with the stars out in Hollywood, they decided to take imprints of our hands. So the other six men that I invited to go along with me, we all went out in front of the theater and put our hands in plaster of Paris so they could make these imprints. These gentlemen were Mr. Ernest Cross, the first man who flew across the Atlantic in a dirigible, the R-34, in 1919. Another one of the flyers was Bill Deal, who was a flying instructor in the First World War. Another man was Beckwith Havens, who was one of the very first flying students of Glenn Curtis up in Hammondsport, New York. Then Harry Bruno, who has been interested in aviation since 1910, and he handled most of the publicity for Charles Lindbergh when he flew the Atlantic. Another man was Bert Balkan, who was flying with Admiral Byrd, and he flew with him on every trip he made over the North Pole and the South Pole. And the other gentleman was Clarence Chamberlain, who flew the Atlantic just 2 weeks after Lindbergh made his trip, except he flew about 800 miles further and was in the air 45 hours, whereas Lindbergh was in the air only 33 hours and 30 minutes.
You just mentioned Lindbergh. Did you ever meet Lindbergh, Peck?
Yes, I met Colonel Lindbergh when he first arrived at Roosevelt Field in on his trip from California. He stopped off in St. Louis and then came through to New York. And after several days' delay, he finally took off in precarious weather. He didn't know whether he was going to have good weather going across or not. It turned out to be pretty bad weather. Well, I sailed the next day on the steamship Leviathan for Cherbourg, France, and Southampton, England. I was chief radio officer on the Leviathan at that time. On the following night, we received word by radio that he had just landed at Le Bourget flying field in Paris. And with the 3,700 passengers on board, as soon as I announced that over the loudspeaker throughout the ship, the passengers went wild and they all rushed for the smoking room to buy up all the champagne and other drinks they could get hold of. So very few people went to bed that night on the ship. In the meantime, Lindbergh remained in Paris with the American ambassador Herrick for 4 days. Then he was invited by the King of the Belgians to go over to Brussels, and he flew over there, where he remained 3 days. In the meantime, I arrived in France and then went over to Southampton, England. As soon as I arrived there, I got on the first train and went up to London. While in London, walking along the Strand, I bumped into an old friend of mine, Major Perrin, who was president of the Royal Aero Club. Major Perrin happens to be the man who owns Worcestershire sauce, known as the Lee and Perrin product. And he invited me over to the Lindbergh dinner, which was taking place the following night. So I presume I'm the only man who saw Lindbergh take off and make one of his landings in Europe 8 days later. And then I attended the Lindbergh banquet at the Savoy Hotel in London on Monday night.
Here is a picture of an odd-looking machine. Just what is it, Pick?
That is a picture of a plane over in France that was flown by Santos Dumont in the early 1900s.
What is this one over here?
That airplane was designed by a very well-known airplane designer whose name was Vincent J. Brunelli.
What is the occasion for this presentation, Pick?
The first Wright Medal was presented to me by Colonel Hill at the Suffolk County Air Force Base. The lady standing there is the lady who designed the medal, Miss Felicity Brunelli.
You sure get around, Pick.
What are you doing here?
A presentation of the Marconi Medal to David Little, former superintendent of the RCA on the Great Lakes at Cleveland, Ohio. The presentation was made here in New York.
Well, speaking of presentations, on this occasion I see where a bust of Elmo Neil Pickerill was presented to the Smithsonian Institution. You know, it would appear to me, Pick, your aviation pioneering is almost as great as the work you did in early radio. What are you doing here? It looks as if you were talking to an Air Force officer.
It is an Air Force officer who flew a Ford tri-motor into the air base out on the east end of Long Island. And he was asking me about the Ford tri-motor, one of the planes I flew back in the 1920s.
Now, let's look at some more pictures. I see you here with General Pershing. Now with Will Rogers. And I believe this is Admiral Byrd. And here is someone I'm sure you must have known, Amelia Earhart.
Yes, I used to see her quite frequently when she was flying in and out of Roosevelt Field here on Long Island.
Say, here is Arthur Godfrey. What's going on here?
Well, nothing much happened except we had a nice lunch together. I knew Arthur many years ago when he was a radio operator before he started as an announcer. And, of course, he's not only in the radio business, but he's a pretty darn good pilot. He owns his own airplane, and occasionally I see him at one of the New York hotels or one of the New York airports. He really gets around.
Well, speaking of getting around, I remember seeing you on Ralph Edwards' This Is Your Life program when Lee DeForest was the guest. Let us listen in on this TV broadcast.
Here in my hand is the first radio tube, the miracle seed from which sprang the entire mighty structure of radio and television. Sonar, radar, talking pictures, guided missiles, automation, the electric brain computer, and long-distance telephone communication. This tube was the creation of one great man who at this moment is seated on our stage. Now, he did not hear or see our regular opening to our program. He believes he's here to appear on a special program of NBC's Department of Special Events. Now, Bob Warren is ready to make this great man believe that we are just now switching the special program to California. So please cue Bob Warren. Mm-hmm. Well, ladies and gentlemen of the television audience, I'm happy to introduce one of the greatest inventors who ever lived, Dr. Lee DeForest.
Thank you, Bob Warren. You know, I'm here, as you probably guessed by now, Dr. DeForest, but to tell you, Dr. Lee DeForest, tonight, this is your life. I'm glad it makes you happy, sir. I assure you it thrills us. This is a night when we reveal a life of breathless excitement, when marvels happen for the first time in history. We'll begin that excitement in just a moment. Right now, sir, television. Thank you, Mr. V.F. Greaves of Paradise, California, and Mr. E.N. Pickerill of Mineola, New York, distinguished in your own right, Mr. Pickerill, as the first man to demonstrate radio from a plane in flight way back in 1910.
In his later years, Pickerill divided his interest between historical radio and aviation. He was an officer of many organizations and a frequent speaker. He has seen wireless develop from infancy to modern solid-state circuitry, and the Wright brothers' experiments to supersonic jets. As an example, tell us, Pick, why it was necessary to wear that all-leather suit while flying.
This picture was taken before the First World War when I was flying, and at that time, we flew sitting out in front of the wings, there being no cockpits or enclosed cabins for the pilots. You had to sit out in front and look at the blue sky and the hard, hard ground. Naturally, you needed the heavy clothing in the cold weather.
This is my last picture. The Antique Wireless Association has attempted to record the highlights of his career. The Society of Wireless Pioneers honor him by having a chapter in his name. Elmo Pickerill died in a Long Island railroad station, a lone figure in a barren room as the trains roar by. He left no close relatives. He did leave, however, this portrait of a pioneer, which hopefully you will always remember.